Hello. I'm Ozzy Sutherland. I'm the lead for audio workflows on the creative technologies team here at Netflix. And with me today is my good friend, Will Files.
Hey, guys.
Just want to say congrats.
Thank you. I should have brought the hardware.
You should have brought the hardware. Congrats. You brought one home for Stranger Things.
Thank you.
That was well deserved after a...
It was exciting.
That was a long mix.
That was a long mix. Yeah, it was a long, tough mix.
So, well-deserved win for the Stranger Things series, season 4. And I think what we want to do first before we get into anything else is we're going to just play you all something from the season 4.
Yeah, we'll play the opening.
The opening. Okay.
Your favorite, isn't it? How are you feeling today?
Okay.
Are you up for some more lessons?
Afternoon, Dr. Brenner.
Dr. Ellis. What do you see? Don't force it. Let it come to you. Just like we practiced.
It's a yellow circle? The sun.
Very good. Very good. All right, let's see. Okay. Now what'd you see?
Cow?
It's supposed to be a dog.
It looks like a cow.
It does, doesn't it? I never was much of an artist. All right, let's try something a little bit more challenging. Is that all right with you? I want you to find Dr. Ellis. Can you do that? Have you found her?
Yes.
What's she doing?
Lessons with Six in his room.
What kind of lessons?
Six is trying to move a block. A red block.
Can you hear what they're saying?
Something is wrong.
If you've lost the visual, just let it go. Try to reorient.
They're screaming.
Why are they screaming? 10. Peter? Alec, what's going on out there?
Sir, best way.
Six and Dr. Ellis. Dead. They're both dead.
So, remember, this is totally open conversation. I just want everyone to remember that. It's a total AMA with Will. So any questions, anything you want to ask, please don't hesitate to ask a question. I think I want to ask the first question, though. Like, how did y'all find space? And how did you get the opportunity to have space like that? Mm-hmm. To be a, for you as a effects mixer, that's like... the Holy Grail to be able to mix a scene that starts off with like 3-4 minutes.
I know, just, of like no music.
No music.
I know. Well, but it's also one of those things where you have to then justify taking that space for only sound effects. So it was about like, you know, how can we make this continue to change and evolve so that on every cut, there's something new to listen to, right? So if you listen to that sequence, almost every single cut, we're changing the sound in some fairly dramatic way, which just makes it more fun to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't really miss there being music, because they still wanted it to be a dynamic scene. You know, the Duffers still wanted it to be fun and dynamic, and it wasn't supposed to just be kind of chill. It was supposed to be like, you know, lots of things are happening.
Yeah.
So we tried with every single cut to make it evolve in some way. And then to make the sounds have as much character as possible within, you know, the limitations of making it still believable. So it was like supposed to be fun, but still believable.
And do you feel sometimes like, I mean, well, we kind of know this, but I think for everyone out there to understand it, you all have a really good relationship with the Duffers,
yeah.
You and Craig and everyone. How do you get them to, or do they automatically think about sound? How do you get them to think more in detail about the sound for the show and not just obsess over the picture?
Yeah. Well, and they're amazingly trusting. That's the big thing is, I mean, for one thing, you know, this is our second season with them as mixers, me and Mark, but it's Craig's fourth season with them as a sound designer. So they really trust us at this point to just do what we think is the right thing to do. And then they react to it. And the cool thing about that is that they leave us alone to do our first pass. We present something where sometimes we take some pretty big swings and sometimes we miss, but usually they like 99% of what we do in terms of like, hey, we tried taking the music out here, or like when Brenner wakes up in the hospital, we come back in, but everything is like muted until he opens his eyes. And like, that's the kind of thing that we sort of discovered that as we were working on it, because we wanted to continue to have, you know, the negative space and the contrast. So we wanted it to not just be like an on off. We wanted it to come up to a level and then open up all the way.
Yeah. Cause that's one of the things that stuck out, I think, in the very first episode when everybody saw it, they were like, oh, they're actually using space. They're using silence. They're pulling things out. Mm-hmm. They're being dynamic about the mix. And it that for a lot of us sound geeks out here, that's always cool to be able to have those moments.
Yeah. We're always looking for like, what can we take away? Especially Mark with the music, because you know the way we get the music is we get it from Kyle and Michael, and it comes to us in, you know, a chunk of stereo tracks, but usually, and
they don't mix it in 5.1.
So they mix it in stereo still,
because they're still old school on their synths and everything.
And the thing is, like, some of those tracks come in stereo, but it's just a mono synth, you know. So then Mark has to try to do something to actually make it feel stereo, like put some chorusing on it or some delay or something. But he's always looking for space in the music. So like if there's, you know, a noisy section of music, he's looking for like, okay, what can I remove from here to get clarity? So we're always fighting for clarity. And a lot of that clarity, at least on this show, but in general, seems to come from trying to remove things that don't need to be there. I mean, even something like if you've got, you know, wind and stuff going on in a sequence that is heavily music based, unless that wind needs to be there for some story reason, I'll just get rid of stuff. So, you know, the fader, either take it down or take it out. And that just leaves a little more room in between the notes, you know, either whether those notes be musical or sound effects or dialogue, because that's another way we try to put the mix together in a way that feels sort of musical between all three departments, so that the rhythms, you know, the sound effects might be doing the downbeat and then the music's doing the upbeat. And then we try to make it really feel like it's one big piece of music, really.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Any questions on the other end so far? Anyone? No one?
Yes, I do have one question. For example, as a sound effects mixer, how do you like the BG editor to edit the BGs? Do you want to cover the whole channels, the whole spectrum, and then just have specifics? Or how do you tackle that?
I usually ask for things to be laid out in terms of complexity, I guess is a good way to say it. So like I always have my first layer of backgrounds is always the most boring ones. So the air or the, you know, sometimes it's a little light wind or something, but usually it's basically, you know, whatever the bottom layer is, that if I got rid of all the specific stuff, at least I'd have something to kind of glue the scene together. And then from there, it gets progressively more complicated. So if there's a scene outdoors, like in the opening, you know, I might have my first level is just going to be like background outside air. And then my second level might be leaves and wind. My third layer might be birds. And then my fourth layer might be specific birds. So that's a lot of times what I'll ask the editing team to do is if we have a scene like outside where we have birds, or sometimes the same thing goes for something like insects, I might have one of my pre-dub layers be the kind of base, kind of distant birds, or the distant and continuous crickets, or, you know, whatever insects are happening. And then I'm on another pre-dub, I'll have anything really specific. So if there's a bird call out, or, you know, a close, you know, something, a bug that flies by or something like that. And then usually the very last layer would be anything super specific, like a horn honk or something like that, that is not tied to picture, but it's still, we want to, you know, specifically place it, because it's always the specific stuff that I find the directors go after. And in that, it can go either way. Sometimes it's, they go after it like, oh, what's that bird doing there? Or they go after it like, that one bird I want to raise. So it's a lot easier for me if it's on a pre-dub fader to just, you know, if it's on its own, I can either turn it up or turn it down. And then I can ride the other stuff just so they're at a kind of, you know, under level of everything. But again, that goes back to like, you know, looking for space. It's a lot easier to look for space if I want to duck the layer that's more kind of general and only leave the specific. Sometimes that's a good way to go.
Hello, Ozzy. Hey, Will.
Can you hear me? Hey. Yeah, we hear you.
Beginning with, sounds amazing here. Congrats. And I wonder, is this room count to any spec or is it flat?
It's flat.
All right. So my question is about the dynamics. You being a mixer who is used to work for the theatrical releases also, how do you change your mind in relation to that? Because I'm struggling to that, to be very honest.
Yeah.
I have some years working for theatrical releases and I'm not quite happy with the result of my mixes when they play back. I've been exchanging a lot of information with Ozzy and he knows that I'm almost there, but it still feels like, obviously, putting aside all the difference from a production in the U.S. and a production in Brazil. I don't know how exactly things are in Mexico, but anyways, how do you change your mind from mixing for the big dynamic? Because this sounded dynamic for me, but how does that translate to TV if there's a mindset that you have to change for that?
That was a hard thing for us to learn, to be honest. Because Mark Patterson, my mixing partner, and I, we're mostly feature film guys. So this actually, Stranger Things 3 was the first television show or episodic show that we'd ever mixed.
Yeah.
And so there was a bit of a learning curve there. So I guess I can tell you about how we went about doing it. Because, you know, in features, we normally just mix, you know, by our ears, and we're not looking at meters really, right? So we did our first pass of the reel with the room. We just kind of picked the number. We put the room at 82 dB because we knew it would still need to be loud enough to make the duffers happy, but we didn't want to make it full 85 because we knew that that would just give us artificial headroom and make the dynamics too wide. So we put the room at 82 and we did our first pass just by ear, and then we measured that. And then we were measuring with the dialogue was, if I remember, the dialogue was 1 dB too low. So what we did was we turned, I have to think about the math here.
I remember this.
So remember this?
Yeah, no, I do.
So basically we found that we were actually pretty close, but the dialogue was 1 dB off. So what we did was we raised the room up to 83 and then Oh, no, sorry. The dialogue was 1 dB loud. That's mm-hmm. what it was. The dialogue was 1 dB loud. So we turned the whole mix down 1 dB, and we turned the room up 1 dB. So we were actually mixing at 83. And then we mixed our second pass, and then we measured that, and we were kind of right on the number. So we found that that's not a bad way to go. You know, every room feels a little different. Obviously, you know, they're all lined up to be at 85, you know, and reference, but sometimes rooms just feel a little bit different. So we did another project recently where we had to do the same thing, and we ended up keeping the room at 82 just because of the nature of how that room sounded. But I think that's a good way to go, is if you just kind of, you know, do a pass, measure it, figure out, okay, are we mixing too loud or too quiet when we're just mixing by ear, and then change the room level to compensate for that. So that's what we did. The other thing we do is we keep the we use the VisLM meter, and
the new gen
VisLM meter. There's a lot of other loudness meters out there, but that's just the one that we like. And Mark tries to keep his dialogue in the kind of green range on the meter, and we find that as long as the dialogue is anchored, and he tries to keep the dialogue pretty, you know, within the dialogue itself, pretty contained into a small dynamic range, but without it feeling overly compressed. So one of the ways he does that is he uses multiple levels of compression. So not one single compressor isn't working too hard. But he also just does a lot of it with the fader, and just, you know, making sure that if someone's quiet, you're raising it up a little bit and that kind of thing. And then once the dialogue is at the right level, we find that the rest of the mix kind of falls into place around it. And part of that's because of the dialogue spec that Netflix has. But what we find is that, you know, when you're at home, you set the level based on the dialogue. And as long as if that dialogue stays consistent, as long as there isn't anything that's too crazy loud, you know, where you're going to wake the neighbors up, you're okay.
So there is one point I would love for you to touch on that I think is unique to what you all do. How do you check it as you're going along during the mix too?
So we figured out a way on this season to stream to an iPad in stereo. And we wanted to, you know, actually stream it to an iPad with the video and the audio in sync and listen on the real speakers, because we just felt like that would give us the best representation of how it would sound in the real world. Because a lot of times, you know, you're using too much energy in the low frequencies or something like that, you know, with the music. So when you put it on the iPad, you realize like, oh, we're missing some energy in the music here, or whatever it might be. So we figured out a way to basically take the output of the stage. We were taking one of the re-renders out of the ATMOS RMU and feeding it back into this black magic box that was feeding into what's the app?
NDI.
Yeah. Well, it was OBS, which is like the same thing that Evercast is built on, which is like that open source streaming platform. So we were using OBS to capture the black magic and then stream that out to NDI, which is a free open source like video transport kind of thing. And then we streamed that directly to the iPad on an app that could read the NDI stream. So it was only somehow through all that, it was only like one or two frame delay. So we would just mute the room and then turn around and watch the iPad. And what was cool is when the duffers came in, if they were like worried about how something would translate, they'd say, hey, can we just watch it on the iPad? And then we'd just mute the room and we'd all watch the iPad together. And then we would know for sure how it was really going to play out in the world. And then once we finish our pass with the duffers, Netflix luckily provided us a way to basically QC the mix on the actual service. So they have these like private links that they go home, and Ross Duffer watches it in his home theater, which is like the size of this room and really nice ATMOS home theater. So he watches it on his home theater, and Matt goes home and watches it on his like TV. This is like regular TV in his bedroom or whatever. So they kind of do the high and the low, and then they compare notes and they come back and usually they have a couple notes based on that, but for the most part, that's our processes. And we also get the link so we can go home and check. Usually there's areas that, you know, okay, this part might be hard on a TV. Let's see what this sounds like or whatever. So Mark and I will go home and watch certain sections, but the Duffers actually watch the whole episode at home, and then they do their final notes based on that.
I have a question more regarding to the Atmos. Like, I've discovered, like, it's difficult, like, to hear what you're sending to the top, you know?
Mm, yeah.
Like, the top speaker. So it's more like a question regarding of the mixing. What, because, for example, for backgrounds or ambiences, if you send them to the top, you won't hear them. Because the reflection of the room, if you send it to the 7.1, you will hear on the top, no?
Yep.
So what do you say, decide exactly to send on top? Only specifics? And this could be divided, I think, into sections, like maybe sound design-wise and maybe musical-wise. Like, on music, what do you send on top? And in sound, what do you send on top? So,
well, you know, on this particular movie, we didn't put any, there's no music on the ceiling.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so everything is 7.1 only.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. So on the dialogue and the sound effects, we were using Stratus 3D reverbs and some other ones too. But so there's always some of the reverb is always on the ceiling for both the sound effects and the dialogue. So it kind of does a wraps the room
like involving.
Uh-huh. Yeah. But then beyond that, I totally agree with you that I tend to avoid putting anything with backgrounds on the ceiling unless there's a specific reason for it. Okay. So like especially anything noise based like wind or like, you know, wind and leaves and, you know, there's a lot of noise based sounds with backgrounds, and it just kind of fills the room up with mush in a way that you don't really hear it as being up.
You don't discern, right?
You don't discern it. Yeah. I mean, what I found with the upper speakers is that any sound that we are used to hearing from above us is the best stuff to put up there. So things like helicopters, airplanes flying over, birds, you know, sometimes wind and leaves can be a cool effect up there. You know, and, you know, also things that anything that changes like, you know, a whoosh, that can be a cool thing to put on the ceiling. Sometimes I'll even use EQ and I'll sweep a little bit of EQ. Okay. As things go over to give it a little bit of that like natural acoustic change. Because I think that's one of the things that makes things feel fake when they pan, either even if it's on the lower plane, not even the ceiling, is that if sounds don't change somehow, you know, as they move, it sounds fake. Yeah. Because that's just not how we're not used to hearing things that way. So sometimes, like I said, I'll sweep a little EQ or use even a little bit of a shelving filter to change the spectral balance of the sound as it moves. Sometimes I'll print a mono reverb or something like that, and I'll you know, change the ratio between the two as it's panning. Sometimes I'll print a reverb and then put it in a second object and copy the pan and then vary the balance and also vary the size so that the size of the reverb channel is a little bit bigger than the size of the dry channel. So you get kind of like a halo effect as it moves. That's kind of a neat effect as well. Cause sometimes you really feel with Atmos, because it's so specific, sometimes you feel when it leaves the speaker that it almost leaves a vacuum.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So if you do something, size helps with that, but also the reverb trick helps with that a bit as well.
And I just want to say, like, for those of you who don't know, Will actually mixed the very first Atmos film ever made. Way back when that was Brave in
2012.
Jesus, that's
that long. Ago? Yeah, I think that's 10 years ago now.
Oh my God.
Yeah,
we're old. I know. But yeah, that was in 2012 when we did that. I remember that because when you did that and Skywalker and everything else, and then Will did the original trailers too, the Atmos trailers that were out there in the world. So from experience with it, just seeing how the format has changed from then being theatrical and now, you know, we've introduced it into spec for home, and then seeing how spatial's evolving, where do you see Atmos for, you know, the, like, for anyone with their studio or anything out there working right now, do you see them? Is it a smart move to make sure they have Atmos going forward, or is it something?
Well, that's... I mean, it's at this point, it's basically a given that almost every, I mean, certainly anything for Netflix, almost everything they do, they're going to want Atmos. Almost any studio project that we do, they're wanting Atmos. Sometimes for the studio films, they don't want Atmos for the theatrical release, but they do want it for the home release or for the library. So they actually will have us mix in Atmos even if it doesn't get released in Atmos, because the studios now realize that if they start with Atmos, then they can create any other format from that. So when we make the IMAX immersive mix, we make that from the Atmos mix. When we make the DTSX mix, we do that from the Atmos mix. You know, you can use it to generate 7151 stereo because it's like starting with a high res file and going down from there.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in terms of learning what we've learned about, like, how to use the format...
10 years in.
You know, I think that as much as the overheads get a lot of press with the public because they're like, cool, there's speakers on the ceiling, they're used in reality much more seldom than the side speakers and the surrounds.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that... there's a version of if you at least have 7.1 in your studio, you could probably still mix a pretty good Atmos track. And either you could, you know, you could monitor in 7.1 and still do some overhead panning, because I find that almost even, because sometimes some of these episodes, I actually do that in my sound design studio. While Mark is doing the dialogue pass, I'll take it upstairs and do a pass in my sound design studio, which in that facility is just 7.1. And sometimes I'll just go ahead and pan something, you know, with the dome on, or, you know, I'll even just do it manually. Like, okay, I think that's going to want to be up there. And then when I take it downstairs, I can, to the big room and with full Atmos on the ceiling, I can hear what I've done. And it just, you know, opens up, and 9 times out of 10, I'm happy with how it's panning. So, I think part of that's just that I've had a lot of experience with how things translate, but it's also one of those things that, you know, generally speaking, Atmos maps well to each different room. So it moves well from one room to another. So you can make some good decisions in a 7.1 or even a 5.1 room that when you take it to the bigger room, generally speaking, it's just going to map correctly. So that's pretty cool. You know, the home theater version, there's a couple limitations that we've had to just get comfortable with. Like, you know, there's the whole idea of they do the zone clustering so that you don't use as much bandwidth. So your mix gets folded down to either 12 or 14 or 16 zones, clusters. And that just means that you get a little less, you just get a little less definition depending on how many speakers you have in your room. We decided to mix with that turned off. But we did check it a few times. Mm-hmm. We just would turn it on and check it in a couple places where we were doing stuff just to see, okay, what's this going to do when it goes to home theater? But we decided to mix with it off because we didn't want to hamper the creative process. But it's great that it's literally just one click and we can hear it. Like, what is it, does what's that it now. Doing?
Yeah, yeah. It wasn't that way.
Yeah, exactly. Because there's a couple things where, depending on how busy your mix is, there's some edge cases where sometimes something will actually switch zones in a slight way, like that you didn't intend. And for that reason, usually when we check it with 14 clusters, because 12 just didn't. 12 did more weird stuff. 14 seemed to be the magic number.
Yeah.
And I think that's what you guys use in your encoding, yeah. Right?
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, basically, you know, 14 seems to be enough to escape any big problems.
I hope this one didn't go over everyone's head with what we were just talking about there. It's pretty techie and nerdy on that most thing. Because he got us going on the mixing side of it, and then we got into the nerd dome of Atmos.
I don't know what exactly they call it.
So yeah. Spatial coding emulation.
Spatial coding emulation, correct. Yeah. That's what we were talking about. Question from Brazil.
Yeah. Hi, Will. Ozzy. Just for my curiosity, mixing in ATMOS for about 4 years now, I start to, in the beginning, to spread sound a lot around the room using objects. Mm-hmm. Crazy, I think. Not crazy, but... And today I have a sensation that I need to mix more... conservative way, bring music more to the front speakers and be more careful, because my sensation when I was listening at my soundbar at home, that the mix start to fell apart sometimes, you know, to not too cohesive, sometimes losing pressure. Is it possible for you to play a section of this opening with? Show us the ATMOS renders to see, to compare what we're listening, more or less how do our pen and stuff.
Oh yeah, oh sure. I can log
and
in.
If you can comment how you pen music and stuff.
Well, we can hurry up and wait, but in the meantime,
let's talk while we're importing.
So you're asking about this, right? Okay, and you're seeing everything on your screen over there too, right?
Yep.
Okay.
So this is what I was talking about here, which is the spatial coding emulation. You can just turn on and off. And when we mix, I also usually turn off the output limiting, because we don't, you know, we're doing the limiting ourselves. We don't want the renderer to do any limiting for us. So usually when we mix, we'll turn both of these off, and then we'll just check it with it set to 14. Still importing.
Yep, importing. That's actually something I wanted to bring up in the meantime, all this imports. Limiting.
Mm-hmm.
Multi-band compression.
Mm-hmm.
These type of things that you have come to enjoy.
Yeah.
And how to find the balance and the loudness range and everything so that you're still within spec. And what tips, tricks, things have you learned over the years with all the mixing in Atmos and from then going from film to television and trying to find the balance of like,
yeah. So, you know, obviously there's the whole world of limiting that, you know, we have to do with any streaming platform. And we spent a lot of time this season testing out different limiters to see what sounded the best. And
what'd you end up on?
Well, there was the two that we ended up liking the most was the Avid Pro limiter, which, you know, is free with Pro Tools. And we put it up against a bunch of other limiters that were much more expensive and it sounded better. And it has the lowest latency and very little usage in terms of CPU. You can put hundreds of them in your session if you want to. Because I have one on each one of my outputs for objects, as well as all my beds, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're limiting there.
So you're limiting on the objects and on the beds.
So the way we did it this year is, yeah, we're limiting each stem. So I'm making like a sound effects stem, a Foley stem, a background stem, and Mark is making a dialogue stem and a music stem and maybe a loop group stem. Each one of those is getting limited before they leave Pro Tools. So before they leave the player to go to the recorder, they're getting limited, and including any objects that we're using. But then we're doing that, you know, to hit spec and all that stuff. And then on the recorder, it goes through one more layer of limiting for the beds, because all those stems are getting summed together in the recorder, and then that's getting recorded onto the RMU as three stems. So that all gets limited. And then when we make a 5-1 or 7-1 or a stereo, that gets limited. So there's multiple levels of limiting, but all of them aren't doing that much. But the two that we ended up liking the most were, like I said, the Avid Pro limiter.
Mm-hmm.
and the FabFilter Pro L2.
Yeah.
And the only problem with Pro L2 is it has quite a bit more delay than Pro Limiter. So you couldn't really mix through it. So if you put it on the recorder, it's native only. So you can't DSP accelerate it. And you basically would hear a delay if you were mixing through it. So we would have had to offset the video because we don't run delay compensation on the recorder, because that causes other problems. So when we were mixing, the players were all using – that looks better. The players were all using Pro L2 on the outputs. But then on the recorder, we were using Pro Limiter. And that's because it's super low latency and it can run in DSP, so it doesn't add any additional – adds a negligible amount of delay. And then that's what we would use to limit the 5.1, and that's what we'd use to limit the beds for the Atmos. But then for the stereo, we would always do another pass after the fact using Pro L2, and we would offline bounce that. And so we would monitor through – Pro Limiter because of the low latency, but then we would master the stereo through Pro L2 because we found it was worth that extra step. Because, you know, when you're taking this huge Atmos mix and crunching it all the way down to stereo, we just felt like Pro L2 did a better job of like retaining detail, especially on high frequencies. And, you know, we crank the processing all the way up to the top because it's an offline bounce. So you basically just make it, you know, have the most oversampling and the most look ahead. And you just give it every opportunity to sound as good as possible. And then you offline bounce it. But that, you know, if we were doing that in real time, it would create so much delay. Yeah. That anytime we switched to hear the stereo, it would be like off 3 frames, yeah. 4 frames out of sync. Yeah. So we couldn't mix through it. So it was a mixed bag. And then upstream of all that, anyone who's heard me talk about my workflow knows I like to use multiband compression. And Mark does as well. And so we do.
I think we're all big fans of multiband compression.
Yeah, like, I mean,
I think it's one of the most underrated secrets.
Absolutely. I mean, it's one of those things that if it's done right, you're totally unaware of it, but it just makes everything sound bigger and less painful. You know, Mark and I talk a lot about the difference between being fun loud and painfully loud. And we like things to be fun loud, and a lot of that comes from...
You've done a painfully loud thing.
I've done a couple,
yeah.
But that's not usually because of anything I wanted to do.
Yeah.
But it's definitely one of those things that if you can contain the high and mid frequencies, and then let the energy be in the low frequencies, that just generally is a more pleasant listening experience, especially when you're talking about loud stuff. And the other thing that we find is that because we're doing that kind of containment, even on the dialogue, Mark is always, you know, knocking down highs and mids if anything is, you know, kind of too strident, because we like that kind of round, almost like analog sound, especially for this show. So what we think is also happening there is because we're doing so much high frequency control, you know, a lot of the loudness specs, they're mostly looking at the mids and highs because mm-hmm. that's where, you know, human hearing is most acute. So we find that by controlling those high frequency peaks, that we think that it helps our score. So we think it actually helps the mix be more dynamic overall if we contain the really loud stuff in the highs and mids.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
Because
you're basically
sense.
playing into not only human hearing, but a loudness spec that's designed to emulate human hearing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a trick, but it
sounds better in my opinion, but it also makes it so the show seems to jump off the screen more.
Yeah. Everyone good there? I think we have a file now.
Yes.
Our Pro Tools is behaving. Stand by.
We have a question here.
We have a question?
Yes.
Yeah, talking about limiting,
I use the production suite, not the mastering suite.
Uh-huh.
So I have problems with my limiting because I had to put in my output of my pads the prolimiter, but I had to put it like in -3 true peak because all the mixing is done in the renderer. So
you're outputting directly from Pro Tools. Are you going through a recorder or are you just going straight from your player to the renderer?
Straight to the renderer.
So you're saying that the summing is happening on the
renderer.
On the renderer, right.
Yeah.
So this is this is one of those things that when you're recording multiple stems, there's only one way to do it, which is basically you have to create a side chain that is the sum, and then you have all of them trigger off of that side chain. There is a plugin now from Waves that is designed to do this internally.
The Spherix?
Which one?
Spherix?
Yeah, Spherix, yeah. So there, as far as I know, they're the only plugin so far that you can basically link together multiple limiters and have them all function as a sidechain together without actually having to create a sidechain. There's something to be said for that. We'll probably try that on the next season. If we do it in such a way where each of the we record dialogue, music, and sound effects beds into our Dolby Master that goes to the service. But there's no way other than doing some sidechain tricks to make sure that those things don't add up to more than zero. But we found that when we limit each one of those three to that 2.3 number, that at least so far we haven't had it exceed the peak.
Yeah.
I have to be careful and in my sound effects and especially in the hard places, banks, mm-hmm. and that stuff. Yeah, I have to be really careful to not overshoot the zero.
Yeah.
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 And sometimes it's a playing. You have to play with the dialogue sometimes because the dialogue is also has to be a little bit lower just to have the -3 true peak and then mix it all together. But my question is, could be with the new Pro Tools that I'm trying to start a new workflow with the AUX/IO and that stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm bringing the renderer back to Pro Tools. That could be a good place to put a limiter. I don't know.
If you're recording
renders back in, is that what you're saying? You're recording the re-renders back into the Pro Tools via AUX/IO?
I was thinking about that.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to monitoring through my HDX mm-hmm. from the AUX/IO, so it's...
Only thing I would worry about there is latency.
Yeah, as I was going to say, you'd have to correct for latency later.
Yeah. And that's where it might, even though it's the AUX/IO, hybrid engine, all this stuff, it's like you'd really have to look at the latency on that. To be honest, some of the workflows and the bottlenecks or issues that everyone runs into, I think mm-hmm. with Will and I and others fighting for the integrated renderer into Pro Tools mm-hmm. fully, that will change the way this has to work. I mean, it's the last frontier for Pro Tools. it literally is. Yeah. It's like it has to be integrated into Pro Tools in order for all these extra workflows to disappear. They won't disappear forever because I think it's just the way some people like to work, but it'll make it easier for others to get into it, work mm-hmm. with it, not be stuck with, oh, I can't drop a limiter there. I can't do this mm-hmm. here.
Once it's integrated, it's going to be a lot easier for especially projects that are working on a single system.
Yeah.
Right. Or when you take, let's say, the sound effects from the stage that's where you've been working with an RMU and you take the sound effects, if it's on its own machine, back to your sound design room, it'll just be one less step to hear exactly what you're doing on the stage because mm-hmm. the monitoring will all be built into Pro Tools. We know they're working on it. It's just a question of when.
Okay. Always the question. That is always the question.
Yeah. But since we finally have the panning, do you guys want to watch some of the stuff with seeing the balls move around and all that?
Mm-hmm. Sure. Hit us.
So you can see that the objects were used pretty sparingly, really, because part of that was that I was using a 916, sorry, I was using the 712 panner on my bed. So I was doing some of that panning and the overheads was in the bed. And then some of the really specific stuff was in an object. So I tended to only use objects just because I want things to be very specific. Or want them to place them somewhere I couldn't get to with the bed. So, for example, anything that goes on and off the very first, you know, just off the main screen and then that first row of speakers, you can't really address those speakers through the bed. So the only way to get to them is with an object. So sometimes, even if something like the bike, you know, the bike, I wanted to pan all the way down the side of the room and go through that front side speaker before it hit the screen. And the only way to do that was to put it in an object. So that way it would take full advantage of however many speakers you had in that array.
How do you use the binaural settings? Do you place that very close or very wide? You are always changing that, or how does it work for you?
We actually didn't really use the binaural settings for this show in particular because no one was listening on binaural. But I know a lot of mixers like our friend Jonathan Wales that does almost all of his reviews with some of his clients like over Evercast with binaural headphones.
But you actually were the first ones to for the announcement of Ambio.
Oh, that's right. We did use Ambio for the stereo.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the binaural thing, I find that a lot of times for the LCR, for the main screen channels, I have it set to no processing on the binaural. So that feels anchored, you know, just LCR. And then I'll use like, you know, near for the sides and then maybe medium for the rears and then medium or far for the overheads. And then I usually use like medium for the objects, but you kind of just sometimes you almost just do it based on the mix. Like a lot of times I'll find a section of the mix that I know well, and I'll play with the settings until I feel like it represents what I'm hearing in the room. Because there's no kind of one solution that works for everything. It just sort of depends on the nature of the project and also trying to match the headphones to hearing kind of what you're hearing in the room.
Okay. Thank you.
So for me, it's like regarding objects, but more like in music or dialogue. Like, would you ever use, like, I don't know, like, for example, Wallace or specific voices for an object doing any scene? Or will you use, like, in the stems, if you get music in the stems, will you use an object to try to put it in some place or something creative?
Yes, sometimes with both dialogue and music, we will use objects to do very specific things, but for at least for this show, much less so than the sound effects. So the sound effects were got most of the object love on this film or on this show. The music on this show, Mark ended up not using any objects for the music. He had planned on it, but as he got into it, he felt like he was happy with how it was sitting with the, you know, just using the bed. But on some of the other projects that we've done, what he'll do is he will pre-build some, he calls them shells. So he'll take some objects and statically place them in the room. And then certain stems of the music that we get, he will bust them to those static rings of objects that will be, you know, pulled a little off the screen or up a little bit or whatever. And then he can automate those if he needs to, but generally speaking, he doesn't, he just has them sort of placed in space. And, so that's good for things like strings or horns. He usually keeps the percussion on the screen channels only and in the regular bed. And then if he wants to do something to make it feel a little wider, he'll take something like the strings and put them in objects that are a little wider than the screen and maybe back in the room, just like 5 or 10%. And it gives it that kind of super stereo, ultra stereo kind of feel. But again, it depends on the content. You know, this there's lots of music in the surrounds on this film. I mean, on this project. But
it's a film, dude.
Yeah,
they were like 2 hours. It's like a film.
Yeah, it was okay. Exactly. It was a series of films.
Yeah.
But the dialogue, there's very little. I mean, we do sometimes like announcements on the ceiling and things like that. Sometimes we'll do. You know, again, if somebody's walking off the screen and we want to really track that, we'll, you know, put it in an object. But generally speaking, most of the dialogue was in the bed.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything in Brazil? Any questions?
Yep. Alan? Yeah, Alan, depois o Rodrigo. Depois você já.
Well, I know this is an event for mixers. But so sorry, guys. But
Alan's an editor, just for this.
Yeah. Okay. The line is blurry.
So that's for two, right?
Yeah. We're all just doing sound.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. So could you talk a little about all the processes that precede these 14 weeks you took to mix the entire show? So we know that there is an entire chain. And many months of work involved and a huge crew. So could you talk a little about the size of the crew? How many editors do you have? And how many months did you work before the mixing starts?
So the portion of the mixing that was the 14 weeks you're talking about was the very end of it. We were actually mixing for almost 5 months. Total. So the mix started in January and we finished it in late January and we finished it in June, like mid-June. So
like the day before it came out.
Yeah, like the day before it came out.
So, yeah.
So it was a pretty long mix process, but you know, it was 9 episodes of film length content. And which is why everything backed up so much at the end, which is why we couldn't have any time off. Because it was the only way we were going to finish it all in time for our corporate overlords here.
I'm not. Uncle Reed and Uncle Ted needed that, you know. So,
we started probably a year before that. Usually, what happens is once they get back from shooting, they'll start sending, or sometimes even while they're still shooting, they'll send Craig, my supervising partner, my creative partner. They'll send Craig scenes or sometimes just concepts and say, you know, can you start working on sounds for this? So he'll start making sounds. he'll start, you know, cutting scenes and doing little mixes on the scenes and sending it back to them as stereo or 5.1 or whatever. And then they'll put that in the Avid and then they'll cut with that. So they're getting basically work in progress versions of scenes as they finish them enough that they can have us start working on them. We'll do a pass and send it to them, and then they'll carry on, you know, with that in the cut. So by the time they get to the mix, they've heard a version of most of the sound design already, which is great for us in the mix stage, because the duffers don't come in with, you know, here's a bunch of stuff you've never heard before. So it's like stuff that they're familiar with, but it just sounds better and, you know, bigger, and with more details. So the crew itself is not that big. It's basically Craig is the sound designer, the lead sound designer, and does most of the big, you know, monsters and creatures and cool stuff. And me and Craig are the supervisors. And then we had Ryan Cole was our principal dialogue editor. And he did have some help on this season. Last season, he really did almost all of it himself. But this season, because of the length of the episodes, he did have some people who would come in and help him out, you know, for an episode or two. So that was a bit of a rotating crew. So there's basically two people doing dialogue. And then there was two editors who were doing sound effects in addition to Craig. And then near the end, when things got piled up, we brought in some additional help just to get everything put together and keep up with all the visual effects, because there was thousands of visual effects shots.
Yeah.
And then we have our Foley crew up in Canada that we send the episodes to, and they shoot it and they cut it and send it back to us. And it's basically ready to mix at that point. I mean, we usually then integrate it with the sound effects, make sure everything's lined up, but that crew kind of works on their own and sends us tracks that are already basically fitted to the picture. So it's really not a big crew, as you can hear. I mean, it's really only the main crew is maybe six people. So it did fluctuate a little bit more on this season because of the size of the show, but the main principal crew is about six people. And we started, I'd say, you know, Craig started probably a year before we finished the mix, but the rest of the crew only started about maybe 2 months before we started, maybe 2 or 3 months before we started the mix in January. Mm-hmm. So it was a bit of a ramp up period, but basically once we were mixing, that's when the crew was at its fullest once we started mixing, because they were working on the episodes ahead of the ones that we were working on.
I'm going to ask, what do you expect from a QC? I'm asked because I'm an audio QC operator. Please don't hate me.
Yeah. M&E.
It's okay. Your job is important. Your job is important. You catch stuff that we don't, so it's okay.
But what kind of feedback do you expect about a QC? Especially in ATMOS, we have more elements.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm going to stay quiet on this one for sure. I could go off on something. Yeah. Go ahead.
I mean, I can say that as a mixer, the things that are useful are like if there's ticks, or, you know, sometimes we have bad punches where like the end of a reverb tail gets cut off or things like that. Sometimes, you know, when pans don't match, that's a useful thing to know. Like, if the footsteps are in the right channel for a character and the dialogue's in the center channel, things like that. Or if the, you know, a car door is in the left channel, but on the dialogue, there's a little bit of car door sound and that's in the center channel. That's useful stuff. You know, that's the more technical kind of stuff.
I'll defend you all I'll say it. There is times when there is QC notes that become subjective to what they are trying to achieve. Yeah. And when I say that the mixers are trying to keep their creative intent as much as possible, there sometimes is no need for a QC note telling them that, hey, there sounds like there's a, they're talking in it, there's reverb above my head or behind me now. It's like, no, it's meant to be. That's the point in that moment. So we've had I'm not saying it's you at all. We like you. But we've had QC notes from other vendors that have driven some of our mixers crazy. Like they were like, you got to be kidding me that that's a note right now, because I purposely did that. Yeah, or that's what the creative director, you know, the director wants that sound there. And so it's those creative, I think it's drawing, you know, balancing the line between creative and then, you know, objective technical types.
Technical issues that could happen.
Real technical issues, like, oh crap, that punch is bad, or oh, that's distorted off of that left channel, or oh, I didn't even realize I have noise in these things right here, you know? So I think that's where it can get a little
annoying.
There you go. Annoying, because, is what we'll.
You know, yeah. Best QC is very helpful when it's at its best, because you're catching things that we don't have time to catch on the stage, or you're listening on more high definition speakers than we are on the stage, you know, because you might be in a smaller room and hearing more details. So all that stuff, it can be incredibly useful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Keep going.
Yeah. We were just touching on something that I'm curious about is the mixing environment, the final mix environment. You said something about the definition of the speakers. I'm used to mix with horns and speakers behind a microbuff, right? Yep. And I'm trying to adapt. I use a modified X curve because the room is not that big and always work well for theatrical releases. And of course, the client wants to be in the bigger room. So yep. We end up making decisions on the speakers and the room meant to, or at least calibrated for theatrical. So that links to my original question. Do you have an offset on your mind, or do you actually apply a flat curve to the speakers, or...
Well, so, you know, we're in a similar situation where, you know, we're mixing in a room that's much larger than any home theater. But it's appropriate because, well, it's not that big. I mean, it's about the same footprint as this room, actually. It's just taller.
But can you guys describe the room you're in? Just because.
Oh, sure. So the room at Deluxe that we mix in is probably about...
It's over on the
4 meters wide,
yeah,
and probably 6 meters long, and probably about
it's over
4 meters tall. It's pretty tall.
It's pretty tall.
Maybe it's taller than that even, but it's what we would consider a small mixing stage here in Hollywood. Yes. But I mean, it's probably the same size as the room. Which
that's Brazil.
That Brazil is in.
Yeah,
I would imagine. Just looking at it,
this room hardly has 3 meters in height.
Oh, really? Well, it's definitely taller.
It's taller than that room. But it's
twice as tall as this
room. Yeah.
So that's one place that we get the volume from. But the reason that we're mixing in a room that large is because it's a good halfway point between something that's small enough to translate well to a smaller environment like home, but it's also big enough to fit all the people that want to come watch the mix and have a chance for them to have you know, to be in the sweet spot, basically, right? Because the bigger the room, the bigger the sweet spot. And we are using X-curve in that room, and you know, the thing to remember about X-curve is that X-curve is a psychoacoustic it's a psychoacoustic model that corrects for the size of the room. So in theory, if you're using the right X curve for the room size that you're in, it should psychoacoustically translate to a small room with near fields at the same level. That's the concept. And I find that if it's done properly, if it's done, you know, like Dolby spec says it should be, or SMPTE spec, or any, you know, there's all the different X curves depending on the size of the room. And you have to remember that you're correcting for the size of the room, because the bigger the room is, the more reverberation it's going to have, and the more the high frequencies are going to build up. So that's why, you know, you sort of start to take the high frequencies down. And it's not so much that you're EQing the room. It's just that the energy levels are hitting a loudness curve. So it doesn't sound muffled. It's just, it's all a psychoacoustic thing. So basically I would say, in my experience, the science seems to work for X curve, translating all the way from a big room with big speakers with horns, because that's what we mix on, you know, like theatrical JBL horns. And then when we turn around and listen to it on the iPad, it doesn't sound brighter. It just sounds right.
That's a really interesting thing to say, because it is the argument that we have with everyone mm-hmm. around what to do for the room. And, you know, a flat 222 mm-hmm. modified X curve is mm-hmm. kind of like where we say in the spec, like mm-hmm. recommended mm-hmm. style for the room, but it truly depends on the stage. But then I think you just hit on it with the psychoacoustic thing of it and think about it, because there is some mixers who send stuff over and you're like, and then you get hammered with the mm-hmm. the top end. You're like,
yeah.
And then they're like shocked when they hear it and they're like, what happened? Why is it so much top end? Or why is it like destroyed? Like, why is it so loud? Or what mm-hmm. did I do? And like, it's wrapping your head around the concept of like your environment and then also the environment that it's going to play in for everyone else out in the world.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you're at the mercy of your engineer, you know, depending on if you're in a facility that has engineering support, or if you're just doing it yourself. You know, sometimes I would say if you are doing your mix and then you listen to it on near field speakers and you find that it sounds significantly brighter, that might mean that you have too much X curve in your room. So you might want to use one of the, one of the less severe X curves. And you know, there's a lot of research out there and a lot of papers you can read and specs that you can read about which X curve to use for which size room. But it's also one of those things that you may want to just feel it out, because the idea is supposed to be that when you're listening on big speakers at midfield or far field, that should translate at the same SPL level to near field without it sounding brighter.
So do you have Netflix has the 1770.1 spec. I'm right. Like the original Dolby one?
The original spec, yeah. For the dialogue gated spec you're talking about,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. Yeah. So that for me is a very good one, because it translates very well between theatrical to home.
It does.
Mm-hmm. Not the 24 that you have to compress a lot in
That one sucks. Gone.
Yeah, exactly. So what I just did is I made a Netflix film for Netflix, but in the theatrical stage, because the director has used to be, he's always been in the theatrical. So what I did is I put it in 82. I tried to match 82, 80 point mm-hmm. something to match the 27 spec that I am already used to. And I think it translated well. Mm-hmm. Just a little brighter, like you said.
Brighter, yeah.
Yeah, it rings me now because it's a little brighter, but mm-hmm. in like these JBL 705s or 78s are good. In some speakers, it's a little brighter than
yeah.
what I expected, no? But I love to mix in stages because the X-Corp, it's so good for the dialogue.
Right. It is. I mean, you don't want to... You know, you don't want to have too much X curve, though. That it just depends on the size of the room. You know, I have heard rooms that I've walked into and they sound, you know, you can hear it right away. You put up, when I mix in a new room, I always put up something that I know well, or sometimes even just pink noise, and you can hear it right away.
You can hear it right away on pink noise.
If the room
noise,
feels
yeah.
sort of lifted or a little dark. Mm. But you also depends on what speakers you're mixing on. Like, there's some rooms here still in Hollywood, not many of them, luckily, that still have the old like two-way JBL style speakers, like the you know from the 90s, and those really don't have any detail above like 12K. So, X curve or not, you're not hearing anything in the high frequencies. So that's why you have a lot of dialogue mixers and even effects mixers that will low pass the stems. So they don't have anything above, 12K or, with dialogue, sometimes it's 8K, mm-hmm. 7K, you know.
Crispy dialogue.
Yeah, exactly. And I do tend to do that on...
Yeah, I put it on also.
And I definitely do it on the Foley. I always have a low-pass filter on the Foley. And I can always open it up if I want to. But by default, I do band limit my stems because...
And not the dialogue?
What's that?
The dialogue bus? bit of 10K, 6 dB... Mm-hmm. A light one, but I like that because it gets me out of a lot of stuff that I don't like.
Right, exactly. I mean, there's a lot of junk up there that you don't want. Yeah. You know,
especially in dialogue. Yes.
Especially in dialogue, exactly. And so, you know, Foley also has some stuff that's just too high frequency and too detailed, and it sticks out. It makes it not feel like real. So, because the Foley is sort of supposed to be with the dialogue, a lot of times I'll treat it like the dialogue. So I'll ask the dialogue mixer, you know, okay, what filters are you using on your dialogue? And I'll do the same thing on the Foley so that it all feels like one thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then, you know, if there's a reason that I want, you know, some detail, I can open the filter up, but by default, that's what I'll do. And I usually low pass the sound effects as well at around 16K. And again, sometimes I'll open that up for an effect, but in general, there's just not a lot happening up there in sound effects that's nice to listen to. It's usually pretty painful. A lot of, especially as things get loud, there's just a lot of painful stuff up there. So I'd rather keep that space in the spectrum for the music. So the music has all the air in the mix belongs to the music. So a lot of times that's, you know, when Mark and I are trying to figure out how a scene fits together, we do often look at it spectrally and say, okay, you're going to take the bass here. I'm going to take the mid range or vice versa. But the music always gets that very high area because it's just, that's the most pleasant. If you want to talk about what fits well in that frequency spectrum, music is usually the most pleasant thing.
And where did you put the multiband? I was curious.
I
use it in music also, in the music
composed. Yeah,
a little bit, just a little bit.
Yeah, just a little bit. I mean, it doesn't take much. You know, usually you can get away with only needing, you know, 3 to 6 dB of range. But by default, my settings tend to be, I cross it over at about, I guess I'm doing a range like 4,000. The 2,000 to 4,000, and then 4,000 all the way up. I think that's where I tend to put them, but sometimes I move them around depending on the material. But I like being able to control the mid-range separately from the high frequency. And depending on the material, sometimes I'll compress one a little bit more than the other. But usually anything below 2K or even sometimes 1K, I'm not really doing anything below that because that area doesn't tend to be painful when it's loud. So usually that's just a pass through.
Okay.
But again, it just sort of it's one of those things that at the beginning of the show, I might tweak it a little bit, but by default, I kind of just leave the four bands in place in case I want to use something with the bottom two bands. But by default, those bottom two bands aren't doing anything to the signal. They're just passing signal.
Okay. Have you tried the SA2?
SA2, yeah.
That's my last one.
it's cool. It's one of those things that you don't want to overuse it.
Yeah.
You know, because you can really suck the life out of something. But it's also one of those things, it's kind of like, I don't know if you guys have tried the plugin called Soothe.
Yes, I have it.
Soothe is really cool too, but it's one of those things that like you don't want to use it too much because suddenly everything just sounds flat. So you just want to use, you know, a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Yeah.
Resonance.
Yeah, resonance, exactly.
All right. Question from Brazil. Don't remember who was first.
Hi there. I'm Stanley from Brazil. And I was wondering how much effort do you do to edit the sound effects you already received? So you have you receive lots of sound editing. And probably it's amazing already, but do you tend to edit yourself? What do you do?
Yeah, I actually do a lot of editing as we're mixing. And some of that is just because I have an idea and I want to try something. So I'll, you know, move something around or even add something myself from my library. But a lot of it is about, like we were talking earlier about, we approach the mix in a very musical way. So a lot of times it's about taking things and moving them slightly so that they work better with the music. So sometimes we will move things so they hit downbeats and that sort of thing with the music, because it just makes the whole thing feel more integrated. Or sometimes I'm doing things to sort of like dance with the music a little bit so that the music and the sound effects are sort of calling and responding to each other. And I just find that sometimes moving things slightly so that they have a more musical feel, it just makes it all feel cooler. And, you know, sometimes I'm just like, oh, I need a little grit on this thing. And I'll steal some from later in the session and I'll just throw it in there. And it's just sometimes it's just faster to do it on the stage myself than asking the, you know, editor, the sound effects editor to cut a fix for me. If it's a more complicated thing, then I'll say, hey, can you cut, you know, sweeteners for this whole section? Or sometimes I'll even be, you know, we'll be on the stage and new visual effects shots will come in. And suddenly the sync is just kind of messy. And so rather than do it on the stage, I'll say, hey, can you go do a pass on the Demogorgon here and make sure that everything is really tight? Because sometimes when they do the first cut, because the visual effects are loose, the sound effects end up being a bit loose also. Mm-hmm. So as much as possible, I try to go and tighten things up so that we don't have, it's not messy. So everything's really tight. And sometimes I can do that myself. Sometimes it takes too long and I have to kick it back and have them do it offline.
Thanks. And that's a normal reality. So you usually do not work with your last cut.
What's that?
You usually don't work with your last cut. You're always receiving new cuts with new image.
Yeah, we're always receiving new cuts. We're always, you know, changing things on the stage. You know, even Mark does a lot of dialogue editing on the stage.
Immersive picture and VFX.
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, VFX is it's just an ongoing problem.
Yep. You know? We'll solve it somehow.
Yep.
I mean, but just to save on the post side, we're always working to try and make sure you guys are getting the last cut. That's not always happened, yeah. But we're working with that.
Sure. And another one from Brazil?
Yes.
Ozzy, can you tell us about this mixing room, that mixing stage that you are in with Will?
If you come here in February, you get to see it.
We'd love to, but I have a four-year-old son that doesn't allow me to do what I want.
Yeah, no. This is these are our rooms here at Netflix. It's Netflix on Serrano. This room is Scott Kramer and my. This is our room here. It's actually a PMC speaker system we have in here. We have mastering speakers in this room. The rest of the facility is all Meyer speakers everywhere else. But this room is specifically for sound. We built it more like a bigger living room size mix room. The ceilings are about 12 feet high, 13 feet high in this room. And it's like Will said, the size he was saying before. But we have like an S6 in here, Pro Tools, you know, shared storage, all that stuff. We have multiple rooms for the team, you know, so the imaging specialists, the camera specialists, virtual production, we all have our own spaces within this building. And this is kind of where we bring people like Will and other mixers and crew members to come in and listen to stuff very closely and tightly and analyze things and hear stuff. And we can bring filmmakers in and creatives to have them understand the entire experience from start to finish, from camera to that final delivery.
How many Pro Tools systems and what's the configuration of them?
In here? Yeah. One very expensive one. Now we have a Mac Pro rack mountable one, 384 gigs of RAM, like maxed out processors, 8 terabyte drive, you know. One Pro Tool system is all we're using right now in this stage, and HDX3 on it, Matrix out there, and SyncX. And then we have other Pro Tool systems in other rooms too, but for this room, it's just that's what we have, and a Blackmagic card Blackmagic 8K card on this system too.
And okay. On the mix stage that we actually mixed the show on was basically two HDX systems running in hybrid mode.
Yeah, I'm running hybrid mode
here. Yeah, too. I mean, hybrid mode's great because you get, you know, especially if you have a fast computer. So we had two players. The room actually has three players, so there could be a dialogue, music, and effects, but Mark decided to keep the dialogue and music together in one session. And then there's a recorder as well. So the recorder is running in classic HDX mode for low latency. So the two players are, all three players are summing into the recorder, and that's where we record the stems. And then within the recorder, we sum the stems together to create the three beds that we put on the RMU.
Okay. Thank you. Can you talk about a little bit more about the signal flow, because you record the stems at the handler going through the recorder, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And the objects go straight to the recorder, separated. Is that correct, or I missed something?
Well, yeah, so the players, so on the dialogue machine, the dialogue music machine, Mark is creating a dialogue stem, a loop group stem, and a music stem. And sometimes he creates also a song stem, like if there's score versus songs.
Kate Bush.
Yeah, exactly. On this one, we didn't because it wasn't a requirement, but sometimes he'll record two, or like when we did, we just did this musical and we actually ended up recording score, song, meaning like musical song backing, and vocals separately. So, you know, you always change it depending on what you're doing. And then on the sound effects side, I'm recording sound effects, Foley, and backgrounds separately. Sometimes I'll even record sound effects and sound design separately. So I have, like, you know, if there's sound design drones, or if there's, you know, special stuff that I might want to isolate, I'll put that on a separate stem. But normally I just do one effects, Foley, and backgrounds. And then within the recorder, the dialogue and the group are being summed together to create the dialogue bed. The music just gets passed through the dialogue bed. And the sound effects, effects, Foley, and backgrounds are all being summed together to create the effects bed. So we record the stems separately, but then we are summing them together to create what goes on the RMU, which is what we call the DM&E, dialogue, music, and effects. And those get recorded as well. So we have, you know, what we call the wide stems and then the DM&E.
Okay. And objects?
And objects. So we have certain banks of objects that are dedicated to each stem. And then those get folded in with, you know, those get recorded by the RMU. But then when we make the 5.1, they get folded down into the re-render.
Okay. Okay. There is no latency between the stems going through the recorder and objects feeding the RMU directly? There is no delay? No,
because it's DSP. Because it's HDX, so it's the latency is the same for everything. You know, because the summing takes no time because it's DSP. So that's one of the reasons that we still use the recorder in the classic HDX DSP mode, because then everything is real time.
Okay.
So that's where, you know, people say like, oh, do we really need HDX cards anymore and that kind of thing? But there's certain things that that DSP does that native still can't do.
Yeah,
and vice versa. You know, you can't run a plugin like Spiff on, I mean, you probably could on DSP, but it would be hard to code. So, or like, you know, let me take your pick. There's a million of them that won't run down.
Well, all the fat filter stuff too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, you know, it could be that it could be made to work on DSP, but is it worth the stretch? Probably not, especially with hybrid mode.
And especially if they're just a small company trying to make a plugin.
Yeah, exactly. Out there.
Did you have another clip you lined up here?
Well, I was thinking, yeah, maybe we could play. There's the big ending sequence.
Yeah.
It's kind of fun.
I can't lose you. Okay? Do you hear me? I can't lose you. You can do anything. You can fly. You can move mountains. I believe that. I really do. But right now, you just have to fight. Okay? L, do you hear me? You need to fight. You have to fight. Fight! Fight! That's it, Al. Fight, Al. Fight!
your friends believe you have won, don't you? But this is only the beginning. The beginning of the end. You have already lost.
No. You have.
Nice and loud.
It was probably nice and loud for everyone.
So good.
I just want to let you all know we have Will for probably about 15 more minutes because he has another meeting he has to go to. So whatever questions, anything else you want to ask, like, let's do it.
So my question is, this season of Stranger Things became such a horror series. I wanted to have your opinion about how does did change creatively your approach to sound, and that sequences a lot of it, you know.
Yeah. Well, in some ways, the show's always had a horror element, but I agree that this season is the scariest and the most most horror-ish. So we leaned into it. I mean, we tried to create suspense wherever we could. Trying to lean into the horror and the gore of some of this stuff was fun. But you know, we also didn't want to make it overly gory. So like a lot of times on, you know, the blood and things like that you're seeing and hearing, I would often, you know, take a lot of the high frequencies out of that, so it wouldn't sound super, super wet. Because, you know, even though Netflix doesn't really have any restrictions on that, it was also one of those things where you don't want it to be like gross, you know? And, it, you know, mostly we're just trying to give the audience a scare more than anything else. You know, we're not trying to gross them out. So that was something we were definitely leaning more into the horror and trying not to make too much out of the all the gross stuff. Although season 3 had a lot of gross stuff.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Rodrigo?
Yeah. Hey, Will. You just mentioned that you actually only band limited mid frequencies and up frequencies, right?
Yeah.
Is it a worry of you for all this low energy? How is it going to translate on TV speakers? I'm not saying soundbar or someone who is, yep, you know, passionate about it and have a nice system. The regular shitty plastic, you know, enclosure of a flat, yeah, screen.
That was one of the big, that was one of our big driving principles, was we have to make sure this sounds big even on an iPhone, right? And there's a few different ways to create that. The sounds themselves need to have a bigness to them. So a lot of the sounds, especially in this kind of sequence that are, you know, it's the whole, almost the whole sequence is in slow motion. So a lot of things are slowed down and pitched down, and they already have a sort of big quality to them. But then also doing things like taking some of the high frequencies away, you know, we use a lot of reverb and that kind of thing, which makes things sound big. We also do a tremendous amount of saturation control. So the whole mix is running through Avid's Heat, which is an option for Pro Tools that basically makes the whole thing, makes every track have a bit of tape emulation on it, so that it has that kind of tape saturation. And then on top of that, we were also using Soundtoy's radiator and the Oxford inflator. And we were using both of those on various buses, but also sometimes I would use radiator on specific sounds. So like the shotgun blasts, for example, the sounds that Craig gave me were already quite big, but then I would take one of the elements and run it through radiator and just, you know, smash it basically. So I'd copy it, you know, audio suite it and really smash it and make this nice crunchy, you know, kind of, it would basically sound like you were overdriving a tape, like, you know, with that nice analog crunch to it. And it also makes the events longer because it brings the tails out. So what I would do then is do almost like parallel compression, where I would have the dry sound and I would also have the heavily processed sound under it at a lower level. And maybe I would like ride the tail up a bit, or, you know, whatever effect I was trying to achieve, to give it a sound that sounds big no matter what you listen to. So I always think of, you know, like music, like if you think of the drums on a Led Zeppelin record, they sound big no matter what you're listening on, right? And part of that's because of the way Bonham's playing them and the drum kit and the way he's tuned it. But a lot of it also has to do with the recording techniques.
Eddie Kramer.
They're obviously using tape saturation to their benefit. They're, you know, compressing the overhead mics so that they have a lot of, you know, you hear the room a lot. You know, there's all those techniques. A lot of the same techniques that we use to make drums sound big on a record are the same techniques that I use to make sound effects sound big on TV and movies. And there really is a lot of value in trying to make sure that your mix, if the mix is supposed to sound big, if you mute the subwoofer and turn off all the woofers, it should still sound big, right? Even if you listen on an iPhone or an iPad, which is a lot of, you know, we would check a sequence like this, we would watch it on the iPad and make sure, does it still feel big? Even if you take all the bass away. And a lot of that has to do with the selection of sounds and the creation of the sounds in the first place, and whether or not they have a bigness to them inherently. And then using some of the mix techniques like multiband compression, saturation, you know, tape compression, all those kinds of things add up to give it, you know, reverb, give it a bigness that should work no matter what you're listening on.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
When you visit Brazil, Will?
Yeah. I would love to. Let's go.
If Bernardo doesn't stop us from going to Japan, we'll make it to Brazil. So,
hey, yeah. Don't blame it on me.
Technology is here to help us out.
It is. I mean, yeah, I think we'd love to.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Yeah,
be cool if we could.
Be fun to like go through. It's always fun, you know, with fellow mixers and editors like you guys, to actually go through the sessions and look at, you know, how did we do this? How did we do that? Isolate elements, you know, things like that, and walk through the workflow in a more personal way.
I'm gonna just say it here for Bernardo and Laura, you know, Masterclass Brazil, Will Files Edition, 2023.
Yeah, I've never been to Brazil. I'd love to go. Any other questions about, you know, this sequence or the show or anything?
Geeky question. What are your favorite reverbs?
Oh, that's a good question, actually. So Mark and I are both kind of reverb junkies. So we use a bunch of reverbs. I still use a lot of Altiverb.
But you have a library of Altiverb too, though.
I do, but I do. I mean, I use. There's a lot of cool stuff just built into Altiverb. Yeah. I do tend to. One trick with Altiverb. Well, one thing I do with Altiverb is I turn the chorusing on just with a little bit of chorusing, because I feel like it helps with if it helps with frequency buildup. That's one of the only problems with impulse response reverbs, convolution reverbs, is that they can have a tendency to build up in frequencies. Just by the nature of how they work. And then for algorithmic reverbs, we use the LX480 from Relab, which is the, you know, the Lexicon 480L emulation, which is quite good. We used the Exponential Audio, now Isotope, Stratus 3D a lot on this mix. Mark uses Symphony sometimes as well for music, but mostly it was Stratus 3D. That was kind of our Stratus 3D and Altiverb and LX480, especially on the dialogue side. Those were probably our main reverbs for this one. I also like Cinematic Rooms. Yeah, I think that sounds really nice. Liquid Sonic stuff sounds really good.
I'm a big Liquid Sonics fanboy. Like,
yeah, it just sounds really good.
Yeah.
And believe it or not, I still use Revibe a lot. Like Revibe still actually, I think, has some really great sounding spaces.
For stereo ones, I like the Valhalla ones.
That's another one we use a ton of. So we use Slapper, of course, for, you know, especially like exterior delays and that kind of thing. But the Valhalla delay was a thing that we used on this mix extensively. There's a lot of...
Is that on Vecna?
Vecna has all kinds of stuff on them. But like every time we're in the upside down, there's a little bit of basically tape slap on everything. So, you know, when there's a thunder crack, it goes crack, 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 crack. You know, that classic kind of just repeater, you know, like half second or a little less than half second delay. And then that was often being fed into a multi-channel slapper delay. So I was using Valhalla delay first to create that tape slap. And then that was actually going to a multi-channel delay. So it was almost sounding like in the upside down, everything sort of echoed in a weird way. So we use delay a ton in this show, more than we probably do in other shows. Just Mark uses it all the time on transitions and things like that. Mm-hmm. And that Valhalla delay has a bunch of cool, it has a lot of character. We also use Valhalla Room. Mark uses Black Hole sometimes on Hole on the dialogue. Trying to think of what other kind of weirdo stuff we use.
Sound toys, obviously.
Yeah, I use sound toys, all kinds of sound toy stuff. Occasionally I'll use Echo Boy to make a cool echo. Although I've leaned more towards the Valhalla one now, because I think it just has more modes that I like.
Mm-hmm. Basically, you use everything in the market.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, you know, obviously I just named every good reverb there is out there, but principally we used Altiverb, Stratus 3D, and Mark used Lexicon 480 on the dialogue, whereas on my side I didn't use LX480, I used the Altiverb samples of Lexicon 480. So
yeah,
it was a close enough match that I could just use the Altiverb one.
How about the LFE? Do you master it? How do you process it? What do you send?
Yeah. So almost everything that I send to the LFE goes through Pro Subharmonic, the Avid Pro Subharmonic. So I use sends to get to the LFE. But on this show, I actually have two. So I have two sends for the LFE, and one of them is a deep, like a 60 to 90 hertz, a deeper frequency generator, and that just goes straight to the LFE. And then I have another one that's operating in the higher register, and that's going to the left and right. And so I can, it's something like a punch that I don't want to be like huge. If I want it to have a little more guts, I can put a little bit of the first one on, which only goes to the front speakers and is at a higher range. And that helps it feel more connected with what's happening on the screen. And then if I have something really big, like an explosion, then I'll send it to the second LFE send, which goes only to the sub. And that is at a deeper level. So I have that kind of high and low bass generation. And sometimes I'll use both, but usually it's just one or the other.
Right.
I very, very rarely send stuff to the LFE using the LFE slider on the panner, because it usually just doesn't sound very, it doesn't sound as big as what I want it to sound like. So I almost always use, usually it's Pro Subharmonic. I used to use Low Ender, switched over to using Pro Subharmonic because it has more controls. There's some people out there using this new BX subsynth that people seem to really like. I haven't had a chance to play with it yet, but people seem to like it, especially for music.
Yeah.
But one of the reasons I try to use a lot of the built-in plugins, because I have to share my sessions with editors. So if I use a whole bunch of esoteric and expensive plugins, then all my editors have to have a copy of that to hear what I'm doing. And if I send them back a session to conform, to new visual effects or whatever, I want them to be able to hear everything that I'm hearing, because what if there's a reverb tail that gets cut off because of bad automation or things like that? So I want them to be able to hear hopefully everything that I'm hearing. And so because of that, I tend to use a lot of the Avid Pro plugins that come with Pro Tools. Everybody pretty much has Altiverb these days. Stratus, more and more people are getting. On the dialogue side, Mark is using a lot more esoteric plugins because it's really just him. And it doesn't matter as much if the dialogue editor in this case has all those plugins also, but he's not working with as big of a team. So that's one of the reasons that I try to keep it as simple as I can. And, I think that you should be able to mix anything with, even just the stock tools. It's like some of our favorite movies were mixed with analog consoles with no automation. They sound amazing.
Sounds great. So,
yeah. I try not to lean too hard on the super fancy processing, but it's more essential for dialogue mixing in my experience.
And do remember, Sol Levante is on the open source content out there for Netflix, and Will, it's one of Will's actual sessions. So
yeah. So if you want to take a look at, a version of one of my, it's a little bit older now, but it's a version of my mixing template. And we actually made a point on that one to only use built-in Avid plugins so that more people would have access to try it. Cause it was supposed to be sort of an educational thing.
Yeah.
But it's also a fun process to see like, okay, well, how can we mix this without using any third-party plugins?
Nothing. Yeah.
Yeah. It was kind of a cool.
You did it.
Yeah. It was a cool experiment.
Cool. Any last question?
Yeah, no, just a comment on the opening sequence on the creative side. Very nice touch on the scissors cutting the tail of the timer reverb. Very nice.
Thank you. That's something I came up with on the stage, and I just felt like it was just weird enough that I thought it was cool to try. And that was one of those things that, like, the Duffer Brothers, they always want us to try stuff. Just like, okay, do whatever comes to your mind, and we'll tell you if it's not working. And that was one of those things. I was like, is this too weird? Should I take this out? And I was like, no, I'm just going to do it and see what they say. And they loved it, so it stayed in. So I'm glad you liked it too.
All right, everyone.
Thank you so much.
All right. Bill. Thanks, everybody.
Take care.
Nice to meet you all.
Nice to meet you.